What is the number one secret for success? Practice every day. That is the secret. That is the great message, is whether you feel like it or not, give it your best shot every day. There you have it. That's the secret. And sometimes you won't feel like it, sometimes you will, but often you won't. And if you find yourself struggling, realize it's the wow factor. It's you're temporarily stunned by your previous success. This is why you have to practice every day, because we think that, oh, I'm not doing so well. I'm struggling. I better not practice now. No, we're struggling with the wow of our previous success. Like last night, I ended on a high note, just tremendous high note. I am the one singular microclimate isness of the now, and I was able to assert it very adamantly. It was like, wow. So I wake up this morning, I did quite a nice meditation this morning, but the wow factor builds up, and then you feel like, oh, I forgot everything, I'm stupid, and this. It tricks us, and so when we recognize, no, it's just the wow, I'm shocked I'm doing so well, then you get back and you practice. This is really the key, because of course if we don't practice, we're not going to succeed. So getting ourselves to actually practice every day is how we ultimately succeed. There isn't any way around it. And the stumbling block is this wow. If it's unrecognized, if it's not recognized, because it gets very subtle. You sort of go into a shock state. And of course, when you're shocked, you don't feel you're functioning so well, right? But when it wears off, then, suddenly I feel like I'm functioning fine. Like that. But if we don't recognize the wow, we'll end up starting to mentally struggle with it. And that struggling prevents us from practicing. You see, we won't practice because our struggling says, wait, I'm not ready to practice yet. I'm struggling with this. This is the trouble. So instead of struggling with it, just say, I've got a really great wow going here. And okay, great, let me focus on the wow, and let me do some full stop in the wow and honor the wow and remind myself that that means I'm doing great. So if I'm doing great, why should I stop? If I'm going so great that I produced this really intense wow, then why should I stop? I should double down. Speaking of doubling down, Google just doubled down, was it yesterday, the 12th of September, which is coming. I mean, I don't know if they put it up the 11th also, but it was on the 12th on their search page. They actually promoted a movie, which I've never seen before. This is what makes every single one of us human. And the human was the title of the movie by some French producers. Quite extraordinary. You talk about doubling down. So we will have a little chat about this also, okay, as we get into this video. Because I've spoken about that we're now in the conceptual period of the New World Order. I think that, from now to, the 23rd of September, or 24th or 28th, it's pretty much the rest of September, sort of a conception period. And then 40 months later is the birth of the New World Order, really. And the New World Order is a situation where they feel, that they have the mandate and the means to make sure that every one of us confesses that we are indeed human. Every single one of us is human, and therefore we can all get on the same page as what we do as humans. And in order to do that, of course, they have to wipe out religion. Because the truth is that there's not a single one of us is human. That is the actual truth. So Google has it completely, well, they're advertising, and it's the most visited website in the world, Google, and putting that advertisement on there, it means they're pushing this, absolutely pushing it. And it's the complete false doctrine, absolutely complete false doctrine, Antichrist, false doctrine. So Christ, you call it, that's a term for our true self, the nowness that we are. The spirit, the formless spirit that we are. What we are is formless spirit pretending to not be what it is. And in that pretending, we have this appearancing, which we call human world, nature, human. This is all pretending. This is spirit that is merely appearances, light simply appearing as this way. Spirit pretending that it's not spirit. So there's actually not one single human on the face of this earth, and there never has been, and there never will be. And there isn't even a world here, actually, either. Not the way we look at it, you know. So that movie could not be more mistaken. It's teaching absolute false doctrine. Every single one of us is human. This is the humanist message that we've been bringing to light and showing. This is the Antichrist message, 100%. And, you know, it's not a big surprise that the French people were involved in producing this. Not to generalize all French, because there's all great variety, but during the revolution, the French Revolution, they instituted a very strong constitution, a humanist constitution, and they have been the world leaders of humanism for quite some time. We're all human, you know, we're all human. We must, human values, human, 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 human. And the truth is, none of us are human, okay? This is the true doctrine that we're getting through here. Not any single one of us is human. In fact, no spirit has ever been human, even for an instant. Therefore, humanness has never existed. This is the actual truth of the situation. So, in this period here, we have, now, here's another little nugget I'll throw out at you, just to get you going here. We will practice, of course we'll practice, I am the now, I am the now. I feel the now. My feeling is the now feeling. I have the now feeling. I don't have a perceptual feeling. I have the now feeling. I have the now feeling. I don't have the perceptual feeling. I have a now feeling. We're either feeling perceptual or now, and perceptual feeling is really no feeling at all. So I don't have any perceptual feeling. I only have the now feeling. I don't have any perceptual feeling. I only have the now feeling. Okay, so this is the practice that we are working into this video here. And I introduce it gently. I break it to you gently that this is the truth by, you know, we just a lightheartedness here, going over some very heavy issues, but in a very friendly, you know, lighthearted, humorous way. And this is how we do it. This is how it's done. We're not all angry or upset, you know, we're happy. We're elated that we're getting free of delusion, okay? It's wonderful. So I don't have any perceptual feeling. I only have the now feeling. My one feeling is the now feeling. There is no perceptual feeling, actually. There is no feeling in perception. I only have the now feeling. It's the only feeling I have, actually. Now, there's a lot of talk about September 23rd, and I dug into it a little bit last night, and I have before, and I'm very much aware of it, and it is quite astonishing that there have been many, many, many instances in movies, TV shows, various statements embedded in the past. Excuse me. That, now sneeze tried to hit me there, but embedded in the past that point to September 23rd and some, you know, to 2:15, September 23rd, 2:15, people have gone back and they found these. It's really quite extraordinary. What's extraordinary about it is that this is when the pontiff, the Pope Francis, who's, I mean, the ex-pope, I excommunicated him, rightly so, and the POTUS, or MOTUS, Mortician-in-Chief of the United States, are going to meet in the White House. Quite extraordinary situation. And the next morning, the Pope, ex-pope, is going to address a joint session of Congress, which has never happened before. And it just happens that the 23rd of September of 2015, this is happening. I mean, you know, this is something that is worth taking note of. Let's put it that way. And we're not far off. With this day's the 13th, like 10 days away from this, right? So we want to get very much on the road with our practicing here, which is, I don't need any perceptual feeling. I have the now feeling. I don't need any perceptual feeling whatsoever. I have the now feeling. I am feeling the now. I am the now. I am feeling the now. I don't need any perceptual feeling whatsoever. And it's a funny thing in that movie. They interviewed so many, many people around the world. I wonder if they interviewed anyone who was spiritually enlightened. My guess would be no, they did not. You know, they interview all these tribes people, you know, and, real humans. We want to get people who are really human, you know. Well, what is it that what they're interviewing are just people with severe continuity problems, that's all. Whose continuity problem is so severe that they're not able to ask the right questions, they're not able to, and their strategies of are all confused, and they just want to try to improve their mortal existence, so to speak, and, you know, class warfare, how come you have more than I do, you know, this is just, you know, trying to, this is just continuity fear, the dance of continuity fear. So, you know, it's not really very helpful if you don't interview anyone who knows what they're really talking about. You're just interviewing a continuity fear, essentially. You're asking continuity fear, hey, continuity fear, what are we? Continuity fear will say, well, you're human, of course, and I'm God, of course, and this is all there is, of course. You know, of course that's what continuity fear is going to say. So they just went around filming continuity fear, hey, continuity, you know, interviewing continuity fear. That's all they were doing. Pretty funny. Hopefully they have a sense of humor and can laugh at that, you know. How it's, you know, very farcical. Completely farcical, you might say. And the French are supposed to have a good, keen appreciation of farce. Hopefully they're able to laugh at their own folly at this movie. You know, and how absolutely farcical. Well, if they're not, we're laughing for them. You know, we'll hold that laughter for them, you know, when they're ready to laugh at, because at some point they will. Everyone will. We will laugh at our previous folly for sure. How absolutely absurd it was. So I have no perceptual feeling. I have only now feeling. I have only now feeling. Okay, so we're getting into closer here to what we want, which is the now feeling. We said before in the previous videos, I am now, I am now, I am now. Okay, that's still a little bit divorced from feeling, but now we're saying, I am now feeling. I am now feeling. I am the now feeling. That's the only feeling there is. I am the now feeling, and that's the only feeling there is. So I did this practice this morning, and I did great. And then something came in, a little curveball that was thrown at me, and it was, well, how do I harmonize with the now feeling? Can you teach harmonizing with it? It's like, whoa, you know, this is very, how do I respond to that? Well, no, there's only one feeling, it's the now feeling. Yeah, but how do we harmonize with it? Who is we? What do you mean harmonize? There's just the singular now feeling. There's nothing to harmonize with. There's nothing outside of the now. How can there be something to harmonize with the now? There isn't. So you cannot, we cannot harmonize with the now feeling. But this is the very clever trick of continuity fear. And it does sort of give us pause to think, right? Which was like, wait a minute, okay, how harmonize it? But this is what the sophisticated continuity fear says. Wait a minute now, you know. Okay, you feel the now, and I'm going to not feel the now. I'm going to feel something else, which would be nothing. And I'm going to harmonize with the now feeling. What do you mean harmonize? How does nothing harmonize with something? How does nothing harmonize? This is the question. Got a wonderful little fly here that's saying hello to me this morning. How does nothing harmonize? It's a ridiculous question, really. But so there is no other to provide any harmony with now. Now doesn't need any harmony whatsoever. There's no, now is now. It has absolutely no need for any harmony. But this is a very subtle, tricky area. Okay, so I'm just bringing this up so that at least we're aware of it. Practice every day and realize it's the wow that is making you feel sluggish. And if you recognize the wow, you'll start perking up immediately. Oh, resistance means I'm making great progress. Okay, let me keep at it. Now, it's not easy to practice, right? I mean, but it's not easy to remain in hell either. Okay, let's put it that way. And the efforts to delay and keep believing that we're human and, you know, this all this misery and suffering and confusion, well, you can put a ton of effort into that, and you get absolutely nowhere, except you've just made your continuity fear more severe. And so you still have to get free, you know, evaporate the continuity fear. Plus, you've wasted all this time. So that's a lose proposition all the way down the line. So whereas doing spiritual practice is a for sure winning proposition. Completely for sure winning proposition. So if you put it to yourself that way, you say, well, it's a no-brainer. I don't even need to use my brain for that one. If I use my brain for it, I'll get confused. It's so obvious. So the trick is to recognize that it's the wow which is makes me seem like I'm slowing down. Kind of like a diet. Got on the scale this morning. I was starving yesterday, famished. Oh my gosh, it was terrible. And then I said, wow, I must have lost a lot of weight. I get on the scale and I've gained some weight. You know, I didn't eat hardly anything. I gained some weight. How's that possible? Well, you know, in diet, it happens that way, right? You go down, and suddenly you plateau, and you may even go up a little bit. But then if you stick with it, boom, suddenly, you know, you'll suddenly find you've dropped 2 pounds. It's like, wow. It'll go down again real fast. I've been through this many times. So it's similar to that. Is you make great progress, and then you sort of hit some sort of plateau, and you say, uh-oh, you know, it's not working anymore. I just don't have it anymore. No, this is because the continuity fear, because the wow has gotten real strong. And you're saying, wow, if I go any further, I'm going to feel the now. And I don't know if I'm ready for that. And so you get this like feeling like, oh my gosh, I've gone so fast. I don't know if I can go any further. This is the entire situation that we face is the success. So managing the success of our path is absolutely crucial. Otherwise, we will quit. We'll slack off. We'll go into reading a bunch more. Read. Let me think. Read. Oh, someone else. I don't know. I can't do it. You know, and someone else is doing better, but I can't do it. And life becomes very, very difficult then. This pretend life becomes very difficult. Whereas if you get up and say, "Hey, I feel sluggish, I feel resistance," I bet that's the wow factor. And let me just assume that it is. In fact, let me absolutely assume as my first premise is this is the wow factor. It means I've been going so fast and being so successful that I'm a little jittery right now, a little jittery. But that will smooth out, right? As I get into it and start working at it again, I'll catch you know, some confidence, and it'll smooth out. And it always does. It always does. So the spiritual path is never easy. You have to manage your success, and you have to recognize this wow factor. But if you do that, it really smooths out. And you say, okay, I can do this. And not doing it, you know, you say, whoa, no. We've got to keep going here. There's light at the end of the tunnel here. There's the now feeling at the end of the tunnel here. It's the now feeling that's at the end of the tunnel. And we're in this tunnel of perception. And we're trying to get a perceptual feeling. Perceptual feelings, which really is just what? Fear. Is fear really a feeling? No, it's a denial of feeling. It's a denial of the now feeling, actually. So we're only interested in getting to the now feeling. So I am the now feeling. I am the now feeling. That is what I am. I am the now feeling. That is my true identity. There is no other identity. There is no other identity. I am the now feeling. Everything else is mere pretense. Everything else is mere pretense. With no self-existence to it whatsoever. Mere pretense, 100%. I am the now feeling. Any other feeling is just fear, which comes from pretense, and the fear of letting go of that pretense comes from the fear of letting go of pretense. That's all. Fear I won't have a function if I let go of pretending. But that's the only reason it's there. So I am the now feeling. 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 So we get the Google plays its hand yesterday, and so this is a major strike. Okay, huge strike on the world, saying this is our goal. We want all of you to realize that every single one of you on this planet, we want, are human. And we're not going to stop until we make sure that everybody realizes this. This is our goal. You know, do no evil. Make sure everyone knows that they're human. do total evil, you know, right? So this is secular humanism. This is what's trying to take over the world. This is what the New World Order is all about, is secular humanism, okay? Secular humanism, meaning secular means the laws and beliefs and guidance and structure of society is produced by politics and secular belief, not religious belief. So it puts religion out into Siberia. And humanism means that the belief that we're all human. So secular humanism is the new world religion, folks. And that's what's coming. That's what the Pope, that's why the Pope and the President, this double impact, are getting together. The Pope is actually a secular humanist, dressed up in you know, robes of sanctity, you know, but he's a secular humanist through and through and through. He's completely reinterpreted what Jesus' message was to mean that, you know, so social justice. That's secular humanism. He's a naked secular humanist, the Pope. And of course the modus, the mortician in chief that we have there in the White House is so dyed-in-the-wool secular humanist to the utmost. So you have the two top secular humanists in the world meeting in the seat of Washington D.C., the seat of world power, in the White House. Okay, and you know, maybe they'll get married there. That's possible, huh? They say, let's set an example to the world. You know. A secular humanist marriage of the minds. They'll have a marriage of the minds, marriage of ideas there. And 23rd. So that's, you know, that's a double impact right there, isn't it? Extreme double impact. And what Google's pushing this movie is a big, big, big strike. And yet it's too late, isn't it? It's all too late because we have gotten to the practice that we need to get to. I am the now feeling. I am the now feeling. I am the one singular isness microclimate now feeling. The microclimate of now feeling. I am that one singular isness microclimate now feeling. I am that one singular isness microclimate now feeling. Okay. It's a little warmer today. Thank goodness. I am that one singular now feeling. We can just say it. I am that one singular now feeling. That is what I am. I am the now feeling. I am that now feeling. I am that now feeling. I just feel now. All is now. It's now. I am that now feeling. I am that now feeling. So we want to be well down this road before the 23rd. People say, well, maybe meteors are going to hit or something. Well, I'll tell you one thing that's going to hit is the Pope and the Modus are going to. That's going to hit for sure. We know that's going to hit, and that's a very extremely severe impact, ideological impact. Okay, ideological impact. And the aim of that, it's just continuity fear speaking is what it is. When they speak, when their lips are moving, continuity fear is speaking, actually. Continuity fear is supremely adept at misdirecting us and making the misdirection seem spiritual. Okay, sure, yeah, social justice, that's what the answer, that's really what Jesus meant. He didn't mean us for us to practice the asserting that we are that one singular now feeling. No. He meant that we're supposed to be saying that we're all humans here, and we got to care for the humans and make sure that humans are all comfortable and happy and keep believing that they're humans forever. You got to keep the idea that we're all humans going. That's what Jesus came for. That's what they're saying. That's what continuity fear will say. And which is just exactly opposite of what Jesus came to tell us, and still. Is telling us and has returned to tell us, actually, that I am that one singular microclimate feeling of nowness. I am that one singular microclimate feeling of nowness. I dwell in this microclimate of now feeling. I dwell in this microclimate of now feeling. My entire microclimate is saturated with now feeling and nothing else. My entire microclimate is saturated with now feeling and nothing else. I am the now feeling microclimate. I am that now feeling microclimate. I don't have any perceptual feeling whatsoever. There isn't any. It doesn't exist. I don't need any perceptual feeling whatsoever. Because the humanist will say, well, but you're human. You got to feel human. Which is saying, no, but you're pretending to be something you're not. You got to feel that feeling of pretending to be what you're not. You got to feel the fear of that. Come on. You got to keep the fear going. But don't worry. You can buy a new car. And you can be a fearful driver of a new car. It's lightening up. All right. Very nice. Nice day. get one bad day in California and we all start saying, oh my God, it's the end of the world. What's happening? Oh, okay, next day is beautiful. Okay. But El Nino is coming. We believe that it's going to come this year, which is fine. You know, that'll be a lot of fun. Very welcome. We'll welcome every drop that it can, El Nino can wring out of the tropical moisture. I am that now feeling. I am the now feeling. I am the now microclimate feeling. I am the microclimate of perfectly saturated now feeling. I am that. I can be that. I will be that. I am already that. I can be that. I will be that. I already am that. So we have very simple practices here. Everyone comes here to practice. This is what's being offered, is motivation to practice. That's it. We're not answering questions, so to speak. You know, like, what about free will? What about death? No, we're here to practice. We already know the truth, that we have this continuity fear, and we're afraid to stop pretending, and we have to evaporate this continuity fear through right practice. That's all that anyone needs to know. There isn't anything outside of the now. There's never been anything outside of the now. So the now doesn't need attainment. I'm now, I don't need attainment. I'm already now. I've always been now. So now doesn't need any attainment. Now doesn't need any realization. That doesn't need any reaching, accomplishments, achievements, actualization. I don't need any feeling of actualization. I am the now feeling. I don't need any feeling of accomplishment. I am the now feeling. I don't need any feeling of achievement. I am the now feeling. I am that now feeling. I don't need any feeling of accomplishment whatsoever. I am the now feeling. See, humanism keeps trying to feed us these feelings like accomplishment, success, achievement, self-esteem. You know, you're human and you can feel good by being human, by achieving something. My progress, you know, human progress. This is delusion. Okay, that's like, say, fear. You know, fear can be happy by saying that it accomplished something, you know. Continuity fear. Now, I am the now feeling. I don't need any feeling of accomplishment whatsoever. I am the now feeling. I don't need any feeling of achievement whatsoever. I am the now feeling. I don't need any feeling of progress whatsoever. I am now. Progress doesn't exist. I am now. There's no progress for now. Now is not something that is in the process of progress. I am now. I am the feeling of now. So of course we're called here for spiritual practice, not intellectual practice, not continuity. Not for continuity fear to tell us how to practice. You know, this is the Holy Spirit telling us how to practice. And the continuity fear loves to try to take over spiritual practice and say, hey, I'm here now. I can help you out. Let me be your co-redeemer. You know, let continuity fear be the co-redeemer's advice. You know, it says, together we'll go even faster. No, you'll end up in a confused mess if you let continuity fear try to direct your practice. I am the now feeling. The now feeling is the only feeling there is. There is no other feeling. The now feeling is the only feeling there is. There is no other feeling. Hey, that dog is barking. Speaking of that, I had a dream two nights ago where this dog appeared. And somehow I felt this dog had swallowed a bird. It caught a bird and swallowed it. And I said, and there's no evidence, but I said, I'm sure you did. So I tried to cough it up. And I kept trying to get the dog to cough it up. It wouldn't cough it up. I said, oh boy, I think the poor bird is lost forever. But then I kept trying, and suddenly, this bird popped out of the dog's mouth. You know, I was able to get it out of the dog's stomach or whatever. It popped out. Now, I said, aha, you did swallow the bird, didn't you? I was right. And then next day, I'm studying the history of the hippie movement, which is was of course it's took here in the place in the Bay Area, and there's a couple of things I wasn't quite clear about, to say the least, and it helped me out a lot. Is that it actually started out as the family dog gatherings in the Red Dog Saloon. There's a couple of people were responsible for that, and then the family dog shows by Chet Helms in San Francisco at the Longshoremen's Hall and the Avalon Ballroom and the Fillmore, and you know, these. And also, I didn't know that the Fox Theater, which was a theatric company, went bankrupt, and these the people were put on the Family Dog concerts, the hippie people. They didn't say exactly who, but they bought all the costumes. They bought all the costumes. The entire wardrobe department they bought. And this is what the hippies were wearing. This is extraordinary. I mean, you had to have lived here, I guess, to really understand. But we were just saying, what the heck is going on? I mean, you know, it's just like, yeah, all these people running around in costumes with beards and long hair and flowers in their hair, and you know, dancing like maniacs, and you know, high out of their minds, and you know, it was just like, am I missing something? And then of course, you know, the media got wind of it, and the BN, the Love In, and all, you know, Time Magazine, it became huge, and all of the world, you know, the hippie movement was just extraordinary. And Woodstock happened, you know, and it was, and but it happened, started in Virginia City, Nevada, right across, I believe, the state line of California, in the Red Dog Saloon, where there's this man who had these tribal gatherings, had been having these tribal gatherings, and everyone using peyote there. Okay. So it started, it's a drug movement. It started out as a drug movement, no question about it. And they had these gatherings there, and they tried to blend Native American spirituality with music and ceremony and various things. And so that then they had this band called the Charlatans, which I just listened to some of their music. It was absolutely terrible. They had the Charlatans playing there. And of course, Augustus Owsley or something. Yeah, the thing is that they call him Owsley. He's a chemist in Berkeley, and he started manufacturing LSD, which was legal back then. I think it was made illegal in 1966, I think. So they began, the Charlatans, actually their first time they came on stage to play in the Red Dog Saloon, which was the saloon that had been remodeled by these people who are holding these peyote gatherings. They took acid, dropped acid, and played, and then you had all this, everyone was just dancing and performance, theater, and dressed up in all these different outfits. That was before they bought the Fox wardrobe, Fox Theater wardrobe. But, and this was the beginning of the hippie movement. And then people involved with that eventually came to San Francisco and started putting on music shows. They got some bands from the local area that they felt were promoting this sort of situation. And you know, spiking the Kool-Aid with acid. And then people would dress up in this just bizarre costumes and go just dance like lunatics. Very similar to the pagan religions of, you know, Roman times, Dionysian cult, things like that. And so we had a cult of Dionysus really taking place in the Bay Area. So, and it affected people. Everyone's lived here, affected them profoundly. It affected me absolutely profoundly. I'm still got problems from it, you know, absolutely. So, but I looked at these guys, you know, I said, why did I try to be involved in this in any way whatsoever, you know, because I don't want to be like these people. I don't, you know, no way. Well, because I was such a musician, I felt the only people I could relate with are musicians. And so I said, okay, who are my local musicians? This is just my complete, total samskaras, the habits that I brought into this lifetime. I only related with musicians. That was my entire life. And so here I'm in the Bay Area, and I say, okay, where are the musicians? I just like drawn like a moth to a flame, and it just and there's no thought of, I can't relate to anybody else. So I tried to learn how to relate to these people, but they're, you know, whacked out of their minds on acid. And I said, wow, you know, I'm having a lot of trouble here, you know, but I mean, let's talk about music. Let's see what kind of music we want to play. I mean, what's the musical scene? And that this was my life, my identity, previous life, I've spoken of before. And so I felt no choice but to try to get into this somehow, to relate to it, identify with it. So I ended up identifying with it, but I said, no, I can't really get into it, because this is just, you know, it's just these people are a little too nuts for me, to say the least. And I really didn't like the music that much. But I was trying to figure it out. I said, what can we do with the musical scene? I felt like I needed to be, you know, a musical impresario, a leader of musical culture, because that's what I was in a previous life. Johannes Brahms is who I was in a previous, just to this. And then, of course, I had 31 other lives previous to that. And I was a leading cultural figure in music. So I was supposed to guide culture musically. That was my whole thing that I was into. You know, setting the bar. This is, you know, this is the standard for music in our culture, European culture, world culture. So in the Bay Area, I said, okay, I need to set the standard for what is going to be our musical culture here. So automatically then, I was drawn into the whole music scene in the Bay Area, and absolutely, you know, basically destroyed me. So my freedom, the bird, you know, bird is the one's able to fly. You know, my ability to fly naturally high, you know, was swallowed by this dog. This is the dream. The family dog swallowed the bird. And I said, hey, cough it up. I know it's in there somewhere. Finally, I'll get the dog to cough this up. So the family dog was the name of Chet Helms, the group that, this sort of group that put on all these concerts, that sponsored and put on all these concerts. Then Bill Graham came into the scene also. And, you know, this went on for several years, I think through 68. Every week, I mean, I knew people from my high school. Well, I wasn't in high school at that time, but we knew of people from the area who were in high school, and some even in junior high school, who were going up to these concerts in San Francisco and coming back with just these wild tales. I mean, you know, so it was filtering back. The information was filtering back to us. There's just some absolutely unbelievable stuff going on there, you know, up in San Francisco. You just can't believe it. Well, yeah, I guess if you walk into a ballroom and drink a Kool-Aid, a spike with LSD, and everybody's dressed up as, you know, clowns, and, you know, this was a theatrical company, so, I mean, they're just, you know, wild costumes, and wild men and wild women, and everybody's spinning around with their arms up in the air, shrieking and jumping up and down, and the band is playing psychedelic rock, and they're, you know, high on acid too, and it goes on, you know, half of the night. You know, I guess when you came back to suburbia, nice little corporate suburbia, you might have some wild tales to tell. And they certainly did. So I said, hey, I needed to take, you know, I need to get to the top of the music scene. So, you know, who's who, what's going on here? So, you know, I started playing guitar, bring my guitar, where, hey, let's play some music. Okay, now, who, you know, what's going on here? Where are you getting this music from? What's happening? And everybody's like, hey, man, you know, just like, wow. They're all so stoned out of their minds, you know, they you couldn't communicate with them. You know, so I'm like, you know, this ultra serious musician, you know, trying to dig the scene. That was just, you know, completely whacked out of his mind. And I'm saying, well, you know, okay, now, well, you know, how can we build this music scene up to something really uplifting for everybody in humanity, quote-unquote humanity, but how can we, you know, get something genuinely spiritual about this music? Can we do, you know? But everybody was just like, so, oh, I'm hitchhiking out of town. They're just so, you know, moving in, moving out, moving in, moving out, crashing here. All the hippies, they had just crash pads. You know, they didn't have any money. They just hitchhiked. They didn't have any money. So you just hitchhike somewhere. A couple days, you know, day or two, you get somewhere, another city. Hitchhike from the Midwest out to San Francisco. You may not have had anything to eat on the way. And you just go to a hippie crash pad there where there might be 30 people just crashing out on the floor. And then you go down to the digger's commune and you get some free food. And keep yourself from starving to death. You don't have a penny on you. And if somebody's got some weed, you know, some drugs, and they take those, oh, man, if you, yeah, and then go to the concerts, you know, oh, man, this is great. And then, you know, you feel like moving on, you hitchhike up, you know, to Seattle or something, or up to Canada, and they just kept moving around. It's a very transient situation, very transient. So, you know, I was baffled by the situation. And the music kept changing so fast. You know, the Beatles hit, and I had to adapt to that. I said, okay, well, this is the new music scene. I was just trying to get on top of the music scene, which is where I was used to being. For me, that was what I am, on top of the music scene. But I couldn't get on top of the music scene. It was so crazy, and so many drugs, and so transient, and you know, the war and the protests. You know, so this is the problem. I lost my ability to fly. You know, to really fly. The dog, family dog, swallowed it, which is very true. So that's symbology in the dream. You see how brilliant dreams are? I mean, they're more brilliant than we realize. Here's this thing of a family dog swallowed the bird, and I said, oh, that's awful. I think you got a bird there. Nobody else is caring about that. I don't know. But I was the one who said, no, I think you swallowed that bird. I want that bird out of there. And I was the one that was persistent, kept working on that dog until finally it coughed it up. And you know, everyone was very surprised. And everybody else had given up on it. But I didn't give up on it. And the next day, I read the history of the hippie movement and find out about the family dog. I did not understand that connection. So, it turns out that this dream knew about it. You see, my spirit knew about it somehow and pointed it out so that this awareness, this clarity could be worked on, you know? We drove through Haight-Ashbury in 1967, my parents. We went up there on a day trip to find out what it's all about. And holy cow, you know, it was like going into a different world. And you just and say, okay, this is the music scene. Okay, there's people with guitars and flutes and banjos and music, you know, going on in the street all over the place, and music blasting from apartment buildings, you know, crash pads. And people dressed up in, like, you know, Barbary pirates and, you know, Victorian dandies and ladies, and then people dressed up in transient, like bum clothes, you know, they're transients. That was also a big fashion. Barefoot, most people were barefoot, you know, wild hair, and just like, what is this? Their eyes are like the biggest saucers, you know. But for me, it was like, okay, you know, what's the music scene? How can I be part of the music scene? And then the music scene got into jamming and long, long tracks and albums on FM radio, whether, you know, for hours. And so that's what I tried to do then. I tried to go to shift into just long jam sessions and say, how can I? So anyway, it was very, 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 very bad for me, to put it mildly. My spirit got swallowed up by the family dog. You know? So now I was able to, the dog coughed up my spirit, which is a great dream. Now, the bird didn't look in very good condition. It's like, oh my gosh, is it alive? But it's out, you know, it's out. And I can, spirit being spirit, it can certainly, you know, regain its wings. But most of those musicians were rough characters, let me tell you. And most of the music they did wasn't very good. A lot of the psychedelic bands in San Francisco. It was just drug music, freak out music for these people to just, go into some Dionysian, 2 hour frenzy. 3 hour, 4 hour, whatever. I had people come up there, I knew we were taking photographs, they're photographers of the whole thing. It was the hip thing, and then this whole thing then eventually came spread out through the world, and everybody thought that they needed to emulate this thing. But it was really nasty, actually. The truth be told, it was nasty. I think George Harrison came to Haight-Ashbury in 67, wasn't it? What he saw, it caused him to stop taking acid. He said, "Nah, forget it, man. If this, look, this is what it is. Forget it." No way. So it was a bad place to be, actually, for me. Very bad place, and it was very terrible, to say the very. This is an understatement. And music is what? Perception. It's perception. It's perceptual feeling. And it can lead you into hideous situations, which I'm telling you, I was led into a hideous situation. Which is where, why? It's so important to have the now feeling. This is your spirit. Your spirit's free when you have the now feeling. Your spirit's free. You don't have to be on top of anything. You don't have to be accomplished. You don't have to be in control of anything. You don't have to, you have the one feeling. You have this super saturated microclimate of now feeling. And that doesn't vary at all. It's not vulnerable at all. It doesn't need any accomplishments at all. It doesn't need any augmentation at all or subtraction at all. You see, the music before the acid rock hit was very beautiful. And so I was like saying, wow, there's something really beautiful going on here. And then the whole acid rock scene hit, and, it just became all garage bandish, disjointed, which went on to be, grunge and punk and all this kind of stuff, which, it's politicized, very politicized in some ways. And the hippies, they just wanted to be better human beings, just love everybody. And the free love movement was a hippie thing, which because they were all so heavily into drugs, they didn't like cocaine or amphetamines because they called them, or heroin because they felt those were hard drugs and they're dangerous for you. They didn't drink much alcohol either, but they loved the ethnogenic drugs, the psilocybin. Mescaline, which is peyote. They love the hashish, marijuana, and any other way they could find for staying high. And they did it because these were they released inhibitions. They wanted to release inhibitions, sexual inhibitions, social inhibitions. They wanted to blow everybody's mind, and this is the way that it was. It was just like, wow. Is this really where it's at? Is this the now feeling? Not really, is it? So the world got contaminated by this whole thing. They tried to put a silver lining on it, but it was a side trip, to say the least. Very bad side trip. Where continuity fear is saying, hey, and it's still continuity fear is trying to put a good spin on it. But no. It was a side trip that took us away from serious practice, which what we need. The severity of the continuity fear is not something that can be dissolved by LSD. Okay, they thought it could be. They thought they had found a way to get past the continuity fear, and if hindsight shows us, they absolutely did not find a way to get past it. they thought continuity fear was just some sort of inhibition system, you know, where if they just dance crazy, you know, and they could loosen themselves up from their inhibitions, and it was just, you know, and then they could be free, you know, they could be free to be genuine and honest and all this stuff. But how honest is it to believe that you're a human being? That's completely dishonest. So what they're saying is, you know, we can be free and uninhibited with our dishonesty. That's really what it really was. It's just like we don't have enough dishonesty. We're inhibited. We're straitjacketed. We need to be very flexible with our dishonesty, and then we'll be happy, you know, because we'll be able to keep this pretending permanent. Let's keep our pretending permanent. Now, of course, some that were sort of looked into the hippie thing, they decided, you know, this isn't really quite it. Let's go into serious spirituality. And some did go that way. And they may have fond memories of the whole thing. That's understandable. But I'm just being honest and saying I do not have fond memories of it in the slightest bit. It was hideous. But, you know, you admire the creativity of it all. This is the problem, right? I mean, we love our creativity, so we can't help but say, wow, yeah, it was very creative. But now we find a better way to honor our creativity. Instead of aping, you know, the continuity fears creativity, we can just say, I neither accept it nor reject it. I neither accept the hippies nor do I reject the hippies. I neither accept the acid rock scene nor do I reject it. You know, if I would have known this technique then, it would have saved me infinite amount of suffering. Unfortunately, I didn't have these practice techniques at that time, and I didn't know anyone that did, and I was been searching for them for a lifetime. But now we have them, so we don't need another hippie scene, okay? We don't need any scene at all, except serious practice. Serious practice is not a scene, okay? It's just getting down to business, and this is what we do here. So, I neither accept the family dog, nor do I reject the family dog. Now, some of these people, I mean, a lot of them are very friendly, you know, humanists. You know, Chad Helms is, by all accounts, a wonderful guy, and Bill Graham, you know, not so, sort of. Depending who you talk to, but well, sure. I mean, most people are kind of nice, right? So what? You know, what does that mean? You know, does it mean they're enlightened? No. So we have a serious problem here, and we're not, you know, we don't have time for, well, they're a nice person. So what does that mean? That they have a nice facade of around their dishonesty, around their continuity fear? How does that help us? How does that help anyone? It doesn't help us at all, actually. We like to think it does, and there's this, you know, social justice, folk ethic kind of thing. Well, if we all just kind of smile. Well, we've tried that. It didn't work. It's much, much better to be practicing, spiritually practicing silently in yourself as you go about the world than it is to try and, you know, smile at people and say, hi, how are you? Have a nice day, you know. I mean, because I believe that it impacts people at a subtle level, but it's much more profound. Now, there's nothing wrong with being a nice person, but if you're a nice person without spiritual practice, you're part of the problem. This is part of the problem. Because it's saying, hey, we can be happy being humans. This is what they're really saying. I'm a happy human. You can be a happy human. I'm an okay human. You're an okay human. Like, in other words, we can be happy with our dishonesty. We can be happy with our pretending. We'll find a way if we just all, you know, drop acid and jump in the lake, you know, together. And then, you know, put flowers in our hair and roll around in the mud. Yeah. And then smoke a peace pipe together. We can all be happy as happy humans. patently false, patently false, extraordinarily false and misleading. We're only going to be happy when we are experiencing the now feeling and abiding in the now feeling, not mixed up with a whole bunch of not trying to harmonize with a whole bunch of perceptual feeling on top of that. So drugs make you think you can harmonize perceptuality with now. Okay, you cannot. There's no harmonizing with now. Now is complete and total. It's right now. See, it's right now. This is what we have to get at. There's no harmonizing with right now. There is no harmonizing with right now. It is the right now-ness that is the feeling. So drugs led us away from that. They led us away from that. And sure, they threw up, you know, the accoutrement, spiritual accoutrement around it. You know, oh yeah, they'd go over to India. I mean, the hippie trail, Athens to Istanbul, you know, through Iran, and then into Afghanistan, Kabul, and through the Khyber Pass, Rawalpindi, and then into India, and then either to Goa or Kathmandu, Nepal. And this was, you know, hundreds and hundreds of thousands of people hit, you know, traveling this hippie trail, going to Nepal and India. And yeah, they pick up some, you know, hashish there, and they do some chanting, Om Namah Shivaya, Om Namah Shivaya, and dancing, and, you know, high. And then, of course, it was legal. I mean, the sadhus over there smoking hashish like crazy. A lot of the sadhus, not all of them by any means. But so they, you know, they said, wow, you know, it's okay. It's legal over here. And they just got stoned out of their minds, wandering around, looking at all the cows. And, you know, some of them got a little more serious along the way. But, you know, they delivered all this kind of spiritual patter, you know, that through all the hippie magazines. There's so many comic books and magazines and underground newspapers that we all read, you know. You go down somewhere at the local natural food store, commune store, you know, which was great. And they have all these, you know, underground newspapers there. And, you know, if you want to blow your mind, just look at those. So I used to go there and read those. You know, I said, what's happening in the world? I mean, what's happening among my generation? And, you know, and the one just a little older than me. And what are they doing? What's going on? What's the music scene? I mean, what's, you know, how can we make this, you know, really something that is trans sublime, you know, transcendently sublime? And this is my goal. And, you know, you get all this weird spirituality, you know, coming back through these magazines, through these newspapers, hippie publications. I can't remember the name of all of them. The Oracle, maybe was that one of them or something. There are many. Haight-Ashbury Free Press, maybe that might have been, I'm not sure if that was one, but there were lots of them. And the magazines, there were some magazines that at the time. What a bizarre, bizarre, strange mixture you got. And so we're like, excuse me, trying to process this. Like, you know, what are all these teachings? You know, what is this stuff? And then you try to read a book. Then you try to get some book. You know, try to listen to Alan Watts and try to, maybe he'll explain it to you. Maybe Alan Watts will clarify it all for you. You know, but not quite. You know, he's. You know, people were going to, looking for teachers, say, hey, you know, I'm confused, you know, I can't quite figure this out. And then there were some who purported to have figured it out. You know, you go to Timothy Leary and Ram Dass and Alan Watts and, you know, these various, a lot of these various, I mean, all these, you know, Hatha yoga teachers coming over and yoga teachers from India, and, oh, Swami has it figured. I'm sure Swami can help clarify all this stuff I'm reading in these hippie publications about, you know, I'm confused. Doesn't seem to be working. I'm more confused. The more I read, the more confused I get. Well, you know, it's just like Gypsy, you know, Air God, or Argot, Gypsy Argot, and Air God in there too, right? For sure, with all the acid everybody was dropping. And so you go to these people now, you know, they some purported to have, you know, they know the answer. Did they really? Answer is no, they didn't really know. They didn't really know. They didn't understand. The real Indian spirituality is a serious business. And they didn't understand that. They didn't get it at all. Some of them more than others, you know, but ultimately, you know, this the technology of right practice is you know, very important and serious in terms of clarifying it and being honest about it. And you're not going to make it, you know, taking drugs. You know, this should be pointed out. The real serious Indian spirituality, they don't take drugs. You know, the serious spirituality in the Indian subcontinent, hey, you know, they thought, look, the hippies said, you guys are crazy. You know, this is not going to work. They had a very bad opinion of the hippies. And you get the big heavyweight gurus coming over here and saying, oh, don't worry, I'll help you just clear it all up. And that didn't end up very well. It didn't end up very well, good either. So here we are, you know, struggling to pick up the pieces and find, ultimately, you know, get it right, which we are doing so and have done so here, really. I can, I will, I've already done it. I can, I will, I have already done it. Well, we're realizing, you know, it's very simple, but it has to be every day. You really have to work at it. And you have to account for the wow. There's the assertions. Full stop on the wow and flipping the script. Right now, as we're talking, we're flipping the script. We're getting the context. We're clarifying context. Okay, flipping the script is sort of like clarifying context. And then assertions, we say, yeah, I am the now feeling. I am the one singular now feeling. I am that one singular now feeling. I am that. I am that. Which brings us into Sargadatta Maharaj, who was a true Indian, true Jnani in Mumbai, Bombay, India, who some got that book and that helped them out a lot. I Am That is the name of a book. And you know what his teacher told him was just to focus on I am. I am the feeling of I am. And somehow he was able to do that. He must have had tremendous spiritual practice in previous lives, Sargadatta Maharaj. To be able to just simply, just like that, just focus on the I am feeling, I am the I am feeling. And it took him a couple years or so, maybe four, I'm not sure, but it actually very quick though. And, you know, he was enlightened. I am that. I am the I am feeling. That is what I am. Yeah, so, and he had a lot of trouble with the hippies too. He'd throw them out, throw them out, throw them out, and say, hey, you know, this is serious. We come here for practice. We come here for to focus, truly focus in here. Come here for the presence. Don't be asking me that. That's the intellect. Don't come here to ask that from the intellect. You have to look at this from a spiritual standpoint. Yeah, he's very strict, as he should have been, because there's a lot of foolishness and nonsense. And the Indians can be that very querulous, to say the least. It's funny, you know. I mean, they have a style of interrogation, which is just the continuity fear style, the intellect that they use, and it's just must drive the gurus crazy over there, because you know. Well, sir, what about free will? What about my destiny? What about this? What about this? What about this? And okay, what about this? What about this? It's all coming from the intellect. You know, it's coming from the intellect. It's coming from the continuity fear. You cannot address those questions like that. The answer is to practice. I am that one singular I am feeling. I am now feeling. I am that I am now feeling. And I'm nothing else whatsoever. Nothing else exists. No other feeling exists. as Jesus puts it, truth is true and nothing else is true. So for those who were serious, A Course in Miracles came out in the 1976, I think. When we were desperate, I was absolutely desperate at that time. The whole hippie movement and all this polyglot argot of spirituality was just floating around, you know, mixed with an absolute ton of drugs. I said, I don't know what the heck's going on here. This is terrible. And A Course in Miracles, I said, oh my gosh, somebody's serious about it here. Here's somebody who knows what they're talking about and they're totally serious about it. You could feel the clear intent and purpose of it. And I said, this is my salvation. This is what's going to take me out of this madhouse that I've been in. It's really a madhouse. The Bay Area was a madhouse. The whole planet was a madhouse by this time. Nobody knew what they were talking about. Everybody was spouting off some spiritual philosophy. And, you know, then they said, hey, you know, yeah, just get high and it'll all make sense to you. And, you know, when you're no longer high, you know, it doesn't make sense to you anymore. Right? That's no good. That's not going to work. Right? That's not going to work. You know, we want abidance, natural abidance, free natural abidance. So here's Jesus with A Course in Miracles. Boom. I said, okay, this is it. So I never looked back. Gradually dug out of the garbage pit there. And, and which has ultimately resulted in this advocacy here for practice, which is what this is, advocacy for practice, not trying to come here and interrogate for answers. What is an answer? What is that? Is that a now feeling? Is that an intellectual, conceptual answer? What is free will? Well, free will means you either both have and you don't. Oh, okay, I got it. You know, that's not practicing. That's like someone coming to the piano teacher, which I was in the past lifetime, I taught piano too, and they say, yeah, I want to learn, you know, I've come here to, you know, lessons. I say, okay, all right, let's see how you can play. No, let's talk theory. Let's talk music. I say, talk music, well, I'm here to encourage you to practice. That's the ultimate goal, isn't it, to practice so you can hear the music? No, I want to talk music theory. I want to talk about the musician. What musicians do you know? Did you know this musician or this musician? I know this musician here. I heard them play. It's wonderful, you know. They want to talk shop instead of practice. So you get these people who don't even play for you. You say, well, how do I know how to help you if I can't even hear you playing? Well, they won't play. Most people wouldn't practice. Did you practice last week? Well, I was too busy. I had to attend a concert. Yeah, it was a great concert there. And I was going to a bunch of concerts and gaining greater breadth of, you know, understanding of music appreciation, Well, did you practice? Most of them wanted to gain music appreciation so they could seem sophisticated, you know. So continuity fear could put on this little show of sophistication. They say, continuity fear has advised me I need to appear to be sophisticated. So I'm coming to see you, and I can say, hey, I always saw this teacher, you know. Oh, really? Wow, that's great. You're very sophisticated. Yeah, I am. Yeah. They were just looking for that, you know, sophistication that continuity fear was telling them to go get that. Because the last thing that continuity fear wants you is to actually be disciplined and practicing. Even if it was music. You see, so what I did was I parlayed my discipline into practicing piano, into practicing spiritual affirmations and this path, you see, which that's the continuity fear doesn't want us to get even near to that. So it wants us to have music appreciation. I have spiritual appreciation. Yeah, I went and saw this gurus. I appreciate the tradition. I have some knowledge about the tradition. I can talk spiritual shop talk. This is what continuity fear wants, but it doesn't want you to practice every day. It does everything it can to distract you away from that. So for me, I practiced piano every day. You know, I was a lifelong practicer of piano, super disciplined and dedicated. And so I brought that super discipline and dedication into this life. And initially, I started out practicing piano again, and then I went to guitar when the hippies all had guitars. Guitars are a new instrument, you know, of music. And I'd practice like 10 hours a day. Every day. You know, I carried a guitar with me everywhere I went. was always practicing. Instead of talking music, I'd have a guitar and say, hey, let me see if I can play this song, you know, and let me try this, let me try this, let me try this, let me try this. So I was always playing guitar, always playing guitar. Taking it with me. Wherever I traveled, I'd bring the guitar with me, and usually, you know, people didn't want to listen. They're talking about blah, 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 barbecue and cocktails and, you know, war in Vietnam, blah, blah. I'd just be over in a corner, you know, practicing guitar. And I got pretty good. I was pretty doggone good at it in my own way. But I kept playing and kept practicing. But then, of course, in Miracles came, and I said, wow, let me start focusing on this. So then I was reading Course in Miracles, focusing on it 14 hours a day. I'd get up in the morning, I'd start reading it, I read it all day, I'd consider it, I'd go through the wow thing, and I'd do it till, you know, 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock in the morning. Every day, for almost 15 years, you know. For a long time, though, I was just super dedicated for it. Now, there are other things I would do, you know, various times. Like, I'd go through a valuing of the world exercise where I'd read books, try to find the most valuable books in the world, what's the most best books possible, and then get them. And I'd just go through them until I was completely done with them. Then I'd say, wow, okay, they're not that valuable. And so I also did that, a lot of examining my valuing of the world. But it was practice, 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 practice. This is what the continuity fear doesn't want you to do. It wants to distract, 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 waste your time, waste your time, waste your time, waste your time. Watch television. Go see movies. Go to a party. Socialize. You know, be an activist in some way. Do this, do this, do this, do this, do this. But don't just sit quietly and focus your attention in on, say, what is truly valuable? What is the answer? Where is true value for me? You know, don't try to practice looking at that. Don't practice looking within. This is what the continuity fear advises us. The advisor, which most people think is God. Some people call it just the intelligence of evolution, or a consciousness of evolution, evolutionary consciousness. They call it continuity fear, or they call it God, or they call it goddess. They're just referring to the advice the continuity fear is giving them. That's all. And some is possible, of course, to confuse this advice with the advice of the Holy Spirit. Just claim the continuity advice, so that's the Holy Spirit giving that advice. Well, not true, not true. And of course, the continuity fear is going to say, don't develop discipline of practice. Have fun. Do whatever feels good for you. Just go out and have fun. If you enjoy it, just go do it, you know, instead of sitting quietly, focusing in here on evaporating the continuity fear and patiently allowing the wow to dissipate. There's, just go out, you know, and just do whatever you feel like doing. And you know, this is the problem. Sounds great, doesn't it? But this is the advice of the continuity fear. And, of course, many people believe this is the advice of God, Goddess, Holy Spirit, whatever, you know, evolutionary consciousness, human intelligence, natural intelligence, divine intelligence, cosmic intelligence, blah, 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 blah. But the truth is, we have to get to this now feeling. Otherwise, you know, we're still trapped in our continuity fear of pretending. And we'll keep pretending we're something we're not. And we'll keep believing that there's some reality to this pretense. That this has something to do with how God created us as a pretense. And of course, if we think that God created us as a pretense, we're terrified to drop pretense, aren't we? Oh, wow, a lot of time already. Wow, because I'm really into it. I'm not aware of time passing, to tell you the truth here. Shouldn't even looked at it. I had no idea how much time had passed. So, you know, the ones that, that ultimately succeed in the now, getting the now feeling, realizing that I am the now feeling. That's all I am. Nothing other than that. I'm nothing other than the now feeling. That is what I am. Of course, there isn't anything other than that, actually. They're very passionate about the path. So if you have a real passion for the path, you know, you really feel this is what I just am totally into. I'm really into this. This is my passion. Then you have to look at yourself as you're going to succeed. So you should be serious about it. You have to manage your success. Because this is the key component. Very few people in the world are passionate about the spiritual path. Very rare. Very few. But there are certainly some. I can't think of doing anything else. I can't even imagine doing anything else. So you need to be serious about it and keep practicing and keep identifying the wow that is, you know, the stumbling block that's always in our way, and be patient with it and accept it and say, no, I'm going to honor my continent. I'm going to honor all my creativity that arose out of the advice of continuity fear. I'm going to honor all the pretense, the creativity that's involved in the pretense, but I'm not going to continue believing in the pretense at all. I'll drop all belief in the pretense, but I'll honor the creativity that gave rise, that was the appearancing of it. You know? So I'll neither accept the pretense, nor will I reject it. Again, if I had these tools 50 years ago, it would have been an entirely different story. The funny thing is, nobody expects a child to be so disciplined. This is the problem I had, is all the adults are saying, just go out and have some fun. You know, it's your childhood, enjoy it. Don't, you know, go out and, you know, mingle, birthday parties. This was so terrible for me. I had no interest in any of that. I was fully disciplined coming into this lifetime, super disciplined, super confident. All I wanted to do was to tell me what the truth is and let me start, you know, let me focus on it. I'm going to get this done. And adults will say, what are you doing staying in your room? You know, get out and play with little Johnny and have some fun, you know, play baseball, you know, come on, have a life. That's no life in your room. I said, what are you talking about? This is no life out there. This is just complete pretense. And the dance of continuity fear. They had no idea, you know, what I was talking about. That, you know, how could a kid be so disciplined? They didn't understand past lives at all. I said, well, we're not that disciplined. How could he be so disciplined? And it's crazy. You come into this world, it's just a madhouse here. You have to understand samskaras or the previous habits of previous lifetimes. And so people come in with this intense focus, intense abilities, you know. And people here say, oh, no, you need a normal childhood. What's a normal childhood? What do you mean normal childhood? Normal stupidity, getting myself enmeshed in more continuity fear? That's what's normal, but is it good? Is it right? Is it healthy? No, it's a disaster. So they couldn't handle the idea, you know, what if some young person is just enlightened, you know, it's like nobody could handle that in this world, in the culture we were in. That was impossible, and to their mindset, completely impossible. Whereas in other, like India, it's possible. You had young people, you know, Shankar, I think, was enlightened pretty early. The Ramana Maharshi enlightened at 16, I think. You know, you have various avatars who are born enlightened, things stuff like this. So it wouldn't be such a shock. I mean, Jesus was fully awake, you know, I believe his entire life here. And so, you know, but you have acceptance of it. Whereas if you appear here in this Western culture as I am, you know, perfectly enlightened, they'd put you in Agnew State Hospital, mental hospital. There's no question about it. So you have to pretend to be not enlightened. You know, it's changed. It's one positive change now is that mental health is treated in a much better way than it used to be. There, you know, the hippies, you know, did, you know, the overall youth culture has made some positive changes, but it's got all subsumed into humanism is the problem. It's been co-opted. And that's what we don't want. But certainly, the way that people who were told they had mental health problems, a lot of them didn't. A lot of them actually just were so advanced that the culture couldn't accept them. So they threw them in mental hospitals, you know, and straitjacketed them. And, you know, some had severe problems, but some did not, actually. They just couldn't adjust. The society wouldn't allow them, you know, because they were so disciplined and advanced. And what they were talking about just didn't seem like crazy. But they ultimately had shut that hospital down. And it terrorized us. I know, I remember I was terrorized. Agnew State Hospital in the Bay Area, mental hospital. We'll send you to Agnew's, you know. They threaten you, send you to Agnew's. Yeah, that was no walk in the park, believe me. Once you get in there, you never get out. So, we are more, quote-unquote, humane in a lot of ways, which is not a bad thing. But thinking that that is the goal in itself is a huge mistake. And thinking that it's humanity is doing is a huge mistake. It's really just we're lessening our continuity fear. To a certain degree, some there's been some lessening of it, and yet it seems as though it's been co-opted. So it's very, what I'm saying is very likely that it's all going to go bad at this time now. Where humanism is going to become a religion, and it will co-opt all the progress that was made. There was a lot of progress. I mean, there's been a lot of spiritual effort and take place in the world over the last 50, 60 years. But it has not been serious enough and not been effective enough, and it's still got too much humanistic leanings, and the context has not been clear enough. So it's susceptible to being co-opted, and I believe there's going to be a huge effort to co-opt it all, which is what I'm, you know, nervous about and adamant about. And we see Google saying every single one of us is human, promoting this movie, every single one of us. We have all something in common. Every single one of us is human. Learn about, you know, the fact that we're all human. Every single one, no exception. And of course, they'll say Jesus was human. The Pope wouldn't disagree with that at all, would the Pope, ex-Pope, excommunicated Pope, what do they call it? Emeritus, the Pope Emeritus, like Benedict's Pope Emeritus. The Pope Emeritus, Francis, will say, of course Jesus was human. He's very human, but he's also divine, and there's a hypostatic union that explains it all by saying that he can't be explained. What kind of explanation is it that, it, you know, we explain it all by saying it can't be explained? especially when pointing to what is not true. They didn't mean that, you know, the way we mean it in non-dual, and like non-dual explain, you know, saying that there is no definition. We can't be defined because we're absolute freedom. That's not saying it can't be explained. We just explained it, that there is no definition because we're perfectly free. So we can't define what we are. But they're saying, no, Jesus was both perfectly human and perfectly divine, and the difference between the two was somehow... well, just have faith. So, of course the Pope believes that Jesus was human. Of course the POTUS believes that, if he believes in Jesus at all, is that Jesus is human. The MOTUS, the MATUS. He's really the mortuary assistant of the United States. because it's the goddess worshippers that are really running this show, who are really just saying that, hey, we found the answer. Continuity fear expressing as saying it's God is wrong. The advice of continuity fear saying that it's God is wrong. But the advice of continuity fear saying that it's goddess is right. It's that hilariously simple and mistaken. This is what they believe. This is what they believe. And they say, don't worry, everybody. Yeah, I mean, the continuity fear has been advising us, all the stuff, and saying it's God was all wrong. It was lying, it was deceiving, it was this. But now the continuity fear, when it gives us advice to us women, because we call it goddess, oh, it's giving us the perfect advice. Infallible, perfect advice. Gotta laugh at it, because this is exactly what's going on in our culture, in our society. So you got the mortuary assistant of the United States, the Matis, is really just taking his marching orders from the goddess worshippers, the radical feminist goddess worshippers, who of course are now infallible because they continuity for say, hey, guess what? I gave men all the wrong advice because I really don't like them. You know, and you know, they're kind of like uncouth, you know, they're not so neat and tidy like you are, but I'm gonna give you the right advice, okay? And so you can trust me now. I'll give you the right advice. Oh, really? Oh, great. We knew all along that we were better than men, and we know the answer. You just tell us. Oh, sure, okay. So we're human. Oh, thank you. I was kind of nervous that maybe we're just pretending to be humans, but now you tell us that we really are humans. Oh, thank God, that's great. And so just be happy having children and enjoying life and being humans. And that's the answer. Oh, thank you. I was so worried that maybe I'm actually spirit and I'm just pretending to be human. And I'm afraid if I stop pretending, I might just not know how to function and just be annihilated. I don't know. But now you're telling me I'm safe from that. Oh, God, yes. You know. And the men just didn't quite understand that is the problem. Oh, I see. The continuity of whispers, yeah. I tried to tell the men this, but they're kooky, you know. They kept thinking that maybe they were spirit, and they kept having these crazy experiences, and they thought that maybe they really were spirit, just pretending to be bodies, but they're really crazy. You can't listen to them. You know, they didn't understand my true message. My true message is that we're really human, and the world, oh, this is all real. The world is real. Humans real. Aging's real. Death is real. But you can just enjoy it. Have fun with it. That's the real message. And you understand that better than the men, don't you? Oh yeah, of course I do. Yeah, I can accept that. I really can accept that. Much, yeah. This is what we've been going through the last 50 years, the insanity that we've been going through here. Nothing more than that, really. Much ado about nothing. Which is refreshing to hear this. It's very refreshing, because we thought maybe something was happening, I just wasn't quite getting it. You know, we have this guilt and this, like, I'm not quite getting it. You know, this, what, you know, well, that's because there's nothing to, now we get it, what's going on. This is exactly what has happened. This is what the continuity fear does. It talks to one side, and they don't quite get it, and then it goes to the other side, hey, you know, those guys over there, they don't get it, but, you know, you're smarter than they are, you'll get it, you'll understand, you'll appreciate it, you know, you're the special ones I've been waiting for, you know, they throw them in the gutter, you know, they're incapable of getting it. Oh, and so then you have this rise of the neo-humanism, saying, you know, we're talking directly with God. You know, God's informing us directly. We're infallibly, we infallibly understand it. Infallibly understand it. We get it. And then you get this modus in the White House saying, well, I know what I'm doing is infallible because I'm getting advice from some infallible advisors who are getting their advice from the infallible goddess, you know, so of course you can trust me and believe me, I'm doing the right thing. I'm getting infallible advice, and the people want to believe that. You say, oh, thank you, gosh. You mean we really are human? Oh, that's wonderful. I mean, we don't really need to pray in religion, it's a bunch of nonsense. Oh, wonderful. I mean, we can get a new goddess religion where we can just, you know, celebrate our humanness. Oh, thank you, that's so wonderful. What a relief. You know, I thought I might have to spend my life doing spiritual practice, waking up to the now feeling, and now you tell me that's all a myth, all a bunch of crazy nonsense, and I don't have to do that at all, and I can be happy. Oh my gosh. You know, what a liberator. What a savior. What a savior we got. The modest, what a savior. So the two saviors are getting together on the 23rd of September, right? and all the people, all the neo-humanists in the world, you know, are going to like believe that this is like the most profound meeting in the history of the planet, that finally we're ready to junk religion, you know, that dares suggest that we might be divine, you know, or we're kind of possible, and we got some connection with divinity, really, and we might be spirit, and, you know, it's murky, but it's, you know, it's also quite alarming, you know, that we might just be pretending, yeah, it's possible. We get to junk all that, you know, time to junk it all and make every single one of us celebrate that we're human. This is, you know, this is like the summit meeting of all summit meetings is taking place within in 10 days' time. This is their nirvana. This is their new age is about to begin. You see, the baby is now forming, and after 9 months, it will be born. This is their baby. They've been waiting to give birth to this baby for a long time. And now here it is, this will mark the official conception of the child that they've been waiting for, of neo-humanism. Finally get rid of that problematical religion, you know, caused all the wars in history. No, it hasn't been the continuity fear that caused the wars and our projection, you know, our projection of our inner fear of spirit, projecting that threat externally and then thinking that if we attack that, we can save ourselves. That hasn't been the cause of war. No, it's been religions that caused war. You know, this is part of their creed. You know, not understanding that it's their own fear of the fact that they really are spirit and really are pretending, which means spirit could end the pretense any moment. That they fear that and project that out onto others and give it form and say, there's the enemy, there's the threat to my existence. If I just protect myself against that enemy, I'll be okay. That's why wars happen. Now, those most people, you know, who are projecting, everybody's frightened, so they want help. And religion say, okay, we'll help you out. That doesn't mean people who claim to be part of some religion aren't automatically end all their projection, not at all. Because they twist and distort, they demand that the religion tell them something which isn't true. You know, which they really are human, you know, but they can, you know, associate with the divine, or somehow the divine can make them immortal humans, so they never have to stop pretending. But it's not the religion that's causing the problem. It's the ignorance of projection and the continuity fear that's causing the problem. It's ignorance that's causing the problem. And secular humanism is built on a foundation of fundamental ignorance. That is their creed. The creed is, let us all be ignorant. In ignorance we believe. You know, there's probably some Latin for that. In ignorance we believe. It was a quo believe, I don't know. Quo ignoramus quo something, right? You can get a Latin translation on that. In ignorance we believe. What continuity fear? We don't have any continuity fear. What spirit pretending to be human? There's no spirit pretending to be human. Yeah. What spiritual practice? We don't need to practice something that doesn't exist. Yeah. In ignorance, we believe. That's the banner that they're marching under. So we certainly don't want to be living in such a place that, you know, believes in such a motto. In ignorance, we believe. Oh, well, I'll leave it alone. My Latin is not what it should be. Maybe somebody here will, you know, look it up. I'll post it on the comment section later. I'm not going to interrupt the flow for that detail. But yeah, that had that inscribed on their buildings. In ignorance, we believe. So it's not religion that's caused the problem. It's ignorance. Ignorance. And ultimately, it's continuity fear that's caused the problem. Ignorance of continuity fear. Ignorance of how to evaporate it. So the real peace bringers are that, like the situation here, bringing truth and clarity. That's what brings peace. As we begin to become sophisticated and recognize, hey, this projection of our inner threat is what, you know, is causing the enmity here. And we have to gradually evaporate this continuity fear. And the only way we can do this is to keep asserting the truth. Keep bringing it, dredging it up more and more and more. We got to dredge it up. It's not going to dredge itself up, really. I mean, we got to work at dredging it up, because cognitive theory is saying, no, 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 no. That's enough, that's enough, that's enough. And the wow is saying, hold on just a minute. So we have to side with the wow and not the continuity fear. Because the continuity fear will try to stop us cold. The wow says, well, wait, wait just a second. So don't confuse the two. Don't confuse the two. The wow is saying, this is great. I love evaporating, but I'm overwhelmed by a little bit here. So let me just kind of slow down for a second here. Let me, you know, for a minute, 2 minutes, 5, 10 minutes. Let me just acclimatize myself to this. We're climbing very rapidly here. Kind of like on a diet, you start feeling the hunger. You don't want to just say, okay, diet's over. Let me go stuff my face again. You say, okay, let me just be patient with this hunger. You know, I'm going to have to put up with this for a little while. And I know that once you get used to it, it sort of fades away a little bit, you know. But there's a certain point where you feel like, ah, gotta eat, gotta eat. Well, when the wow comes, you think like, wow, I gotta stop, I gotta stop. But instead of stopping, just kind of put yourself in neutral. I'm neither stopping nor not stopping. I'm neither stopping nor not stopping. Just kind of in this neutral mode where I'm neither advancing nor retreating, but I'm still, my intent is still there strongly, but I'm just not going to act on it for a little while. You don't give up your intent. It's still there. In the wow, you don't give up your intent. You still have a burning, determined intent. But you're saying, I'm just going to intentionally cool out for a little bit here. Things heat it up a little bit. It's like you're cutting with some saw blade and it heats up too much. Well, you just got to say, hey, if I keep sawing, you know, it's going to ruin the blade, because if when metal heats up too much, it loses its hardness, you know, and it starts getting, gets dulled easy. So, same principle, you know, very similar. You heat the saw blade up too much, let me take a little break, let it cool down, let it cool down, let it cool down. Don't plunge it into water. That might temper it to make it to be too brittle or something. Yeah, that might hurt it. Just let it cool off naturally. And then after a while, it's just warm. It's cooled off. Then you can do some more sawing with it. And it's going to keep its sharpness. A lot of the stuff the young people do, the tattooing, the piercing, oh, I don't know what's going on now, so this is probably weirder and weirder stuff, but what they're really saying is, look, I don't know what's going on, I'm really confused, but I want to appear like I really do know what's going on, so I'm going to do something that makes me look real sophisticated, like I'm really in the know, like this is what people in the know do, they get this type of tattoo, and yeah, I know, I really understand, I'm on top of it, I really know what's going on, and no, they don't, they're really confused, like, whoa, what is this place? I'm very confused. Yeah, or drugs. Drugs help me understand it. You know, when I'm on drugs, I understand everything. No, you don't. You don't understand it at all. You're just saying, well, you know, just I can't. I just can't deal with it right now. I got an excuse not to try. Right? That's what it is. I need an excuse to not even try, as the drugs are. I need an excuse to not even try to figure it out. Well, I mean, you know, that's as fine as it goes. It's a nice crutch. It seems like a nice crutch, but it's got a lot of side effects, a lot of troubles. And that doesn't really get to the issue, right, at all, right? You can keep your whole life. A lot of people in the sippies, 60s, the sippies, or the 60 hippies, stayed stoners their whole lives. They stayed their whole lives that way. Just like, you can see, like, yeah, man, I'm not even trying to figure it out. I'm still not even trying to figure it out. You know, but, you know, we do have to recognize truth. You know, and drugs get in the way. Drugs sort of make a blanket thing. I'm not going to try to figure anything out at all. Or I'm not going to try to be clear about anything. I got this excuse. I mean, it's understandable. Young people, you know, will use drugs because they're desperate, you know, to just like stop trying. I just want to stop trying. It's too much. It's overwhelming. This place, crazy. I'm not advocating that at all. But you have to realize there's a huge downside to it, and you get. And it doesn't turn out well. Or, you know, power drinks, like if I just get really fired up, I can figure it out. And then they just get entangled more and more, like in a web. It's like a spider's web, this world. And you just get entangled in more and more and more. And the more you struggle with it, the more you get entangled in it. So you don't want to struggle with it, but you don't want to just make no efforts at all, spiritual efforts at all. So you have to take this fine line, a middle path, so to speak, of recognizing the spiritual path and managing your success on the spiritual path and understanding the wow factor. And when you have these tools, then you're not going to need drugs at all, or energy drinks, neither one, because you're going to realize, I know what it's about. It's just a dance of continuity fear. That is the answer, actually. But then you say, wow, but it's a very severe problem. Yes, but we have the tools to ultimately free us from that. And then you just go to work. That's all. You don't have the struggle anymore because you have figured it out. Realizing that this is all pretense, that we're afraid to stop pretending, and this fear of stop pretending is what we call the continuity fear. That is the answer to this whole situation. You have figured it out because that's all that it is. So we have figured it out here, 100%, 100%. And of course, the intellect will throw a bunch of questions at you and say, look, we don't even need to deal with that. We're so certain that it's all a dance of continuity fear. It's all pretense. All pretense is pretense. There's no pretense. It's not pretense. And it's just our continuity fear is preventing us from accepting this. But we are the now. We're simply the now. I am that now feeling. Truth is true, nothing else is true. It's that simple. So we have figured it out here. And we don't need to go chapter and verse because that interferes with our practicing. Once you realize that you've figured it out, then it's just common sense. It's just reason. Just, well, then I need to just practice. It's evaporating the continuity fear. I don't need to address any of these other side issues at all because these are ultimately, it'll turn out at the end of the day that too is just pretense and continuity fear, 100%. But the intellect will bombard you with, you know, all these objections, questions, and couched very cleverly. But this is ridiculous. They're still saying, you know, I'm confused. I mean, some truth is true and some truth isn't true. And, you know, no, all truth is true and no truth is untrue. You were just afraid to stop pretending. That's it. Once you own that fear, that problem, You will immediately realize that you're no longer the person that you used to be. You're no longer that person at all. That confused, lost, desperate, you know, you're no longer that at all. Right away, you realize that right away. Because it's called repentance. You know, you must repent. That is just a, you know, Christian term, but it's a good term. Because right away, they say, well, you got Jesus, you found Jesus. Well, what you really found was that you have this problem, continuity problem, and that you're only pretending. What happens is your whole thing simplifies, and they say, well, I got Jesus now, because I have the way. You know, that this is, you know, what they're obliquely, you know, referring to in various, some cases, some more than others, etc. But the repenting means I have a problem. It's my problem. But guess what? That means I can work on solving the problem. Nobody can stop me from it. It's mine. I can work on it. See, if it was somebody else's problem, they could not give me permission to work on it. They could say, well, you can't work on it today. I'm going to lock it up in the garage, and I'm not giving you access to it. Well, if you want access to your problem, to this problem to work on, well, you have to pay me a lot of money to have access to it. Whereas I realize, hey, it is my problem. I don't have to pay a cent to work on this problem. I have access to it 24/7. And I can tell you that, I've always had access to this. I can work on it 24/7. I always have complete, open, free access to it. Because I realize it's my problem. So once you accept and admit it's my problem, this is like I got Jesus, meaning I can see light at the end of the tunnel. When people use that term, well, I've got Jesus, I had this, you know, I've accepted Jesus. What happens is they see a light at the end of the tunnel. Now, that doesn't mean that they're going to easily get to that light if they follow all the twisted, crazy Christology and theology and all this kind of stuff that gets in the way. They say, oh, you saw Jesus, wonderful. That's good enough now. That's all you need. You know, no, it's not. You need to abide in Christ. Not just say, well, I way at the end of this tunnel, I suddenly saw there's a light there. And then it went all dark again and, you know, but that's good enough. No, it's not good enough. You have to, some institution gives you salvation. Here's the Eucharist in there now. But we control your salvation. If you don't come for this, you know, you can't be saved. No, it's my problem. I have the problem. So accepting that I have the problem is the most wonderful thing. You know, it changes your life. Absolutely changes. You're no longer the person you used to be. In fact, you realize you're really no longer a person at all. I'm spirit with a continuity problem. And I will keep pretending and believing I'm a person, but I know deep down that this is not true. This is not true. But I accept, I understand the continuity problem will keep defending against this, so I have to evaporate. I just have to go to work on it. That's what the Holy Spirit told me. All you have to do now is just go to work. But your salvation is assured. And I agreed. I said, I see it. I understand now. Yeah, it's assured. No doubt about it. It's just a matter of you know, evaporating the continuity fear bit by bit by bit. So then you don't begrudge the work, really. You don't begrudge the spiritual path. It's the intellect that begrudges it because it hasn't repented. There's no repentance there. Where the intellect is dominant, there's no repentance. It's the continuity of fear saying, you know, I'm in charge here. I'm in charge. Yeah, you can say all these spiritual stuff, but ultimately, continuity of fear says, you know, I'm in charge. I'll give you the right advice. That's other advice. It's not as good. I got even better advice than that. You know, I can make you free right now. Just give up, you know, give up the goal and just accept you're human and you're free. You know, this is the continuity of fear. Continuity of fear advice. Just believe that pretense is real and permanent and no problem, no more problem. Except the problem is that's not true. It never will be true. It overlooks that one little caveat. You say, oh, well, can't have everything, I guess. Yeah. The premise is wrong. Well, can't have everything. You know, we'll still see what we can do with, you know, the right logic from a wrong premise. Yeah. We'll dress it up nicely for you. Don't worry. Don't worry. So repent, 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 except you have a severe problem. This is what I find the neo-humanists will not do. They say, no, I don't. Oh, I have a bad habit here. Well, you know, it's not that bad. I can kind of temper it, you know. They think it's just about these superficial things that they can temper. Oh, I'm a little overweight. Okay, I can lose a little weight. Okay. But the one thing, again, the continuity fear will never lead you to seeing and recognizing is the continuity fear. Continuity problem. It will never, never tell you about this or lead you to this, and certainly not practicing to evaporate it. If you happen to glimpse it, it will say, well, you know, not really sure what that's about, anyway, you know, let's go look over here. I got something even better over here. You know, whatever it was, I'm sure I got something better over here, you know. The sex, drugs, and rock and roll are over here, or, you know, have fun and life's over here, and be a full, integrated human is over here, and, you know, understand the consciousness of evolution in this direction and all this. So it'll just try to walk past the graveyard of realizing the continuity fear is for that for the continuity fear, that's a graveyard. It doesn't want to go near that one. It'll whistle right past that graveyard. But the Holy Spirit will say, hey, you know, accept it. Accept that you temporarily you have this fear, and let's go to work on it. Let's start gently evaporating it with good humor. And the glass is half full here. I am that now feeling. I am the now feeling. And that's the only feeling there is. I am the now feeling, and that's the only feeling there is. Perception has no, it doesn't have any feeling to give me. It has reactions and emotions, but that's not feeling. The now feeling is the only feeling there is. Anything else is just a denial of this. So I say, you know, so this is what we practice. We say, I am that now feeling. I am that singular, one singular now feeling. The only feeling that there is. I am that now feeling. I dwell in that now feeling. This is my realm. This is my microclimate. This is this beautiful microclimate of the now feeling. And there's no other feeling whatsoever there. It's the only feeling there is. And I am that feeling. I am that feeling. I am that now feeling. No breakfast yet today. No nothing yet today. Let's see if I can get through this hunger, famished feeling for, you know, and I know my weight will then drop quickly again. It will drop quickly again and will go down pretty significantly if I keep stay with it. And then at some point it plateaus out, and then if hunger hits and it you know, really stays with you, and you have to be super dedicated at that point. But we'll deal with that super dedication at some other point. But I have to just get through this one here. That's it. One step at a time. Days to the neo-humanist, what do you call it, ultimate summit. They'll come up with some name for it. They always do. The birth of the new age. The birth of the millennium. The beginning of the millennium. They may call it something like that. The seminal moment in the birth of the new millennium. September 23rd, 2015, they'll call it something like that. Write songs about it. Hold celebrations about it. You know, the new cycle, you know, is underway, folks. It's underway. That's why we got to get a head start and make sure that we're, you know, it's happening. This Google thing is showing you. Where every single one of us is human. This gotta watch this. Watch this movie. Every single one of us is human. Find out about yourself. Find out about what you really are. You know. Finally, we know. We're getting answers now because we pulled all these people around the planet, and we realized they all think the same. They all pretty much saying, "Yeah, I'm human, and this is what makes me human." You see, everybody around the whole planet believes this. So they're ideologically closing the trap. Because we might be thinking, well, you know, maybe there's some place where people actually think they're actually spirit and not human. But now Google, watch this movie and it'll prove to you that everyone believes what we believe. This is what they're saying. It's very powerful. Me, they're saying. Everyone believes what we believe. All over the whole planet. They interviewed everybody. They all believe that we're human. Now we have differences of what makes us human, but we can kind of boil them down, throw some algorithms at it, and we'll come up with some pretty basic creed for the new millennium of peace and love, age of Aquarius, peace and love, harmony and understanding, abounding. Yeah, well, what happened to the threat to stop pretending and the projection of that threat? Well, we can project that out somewhere out there, some other, dimension, some other place, or in the past, we project on the past, those horrible religious people, but we're making sure that never happens again, so we're dealing with that threat, don't we? It's not a problem. We're dealing with the threats to our security, dealing with the threats to our happiness, make sure never again, never again. Are we ever going to have any suggestion that we're anything but human? Any even remote suggestion about this is just stomped on like a little wildfire. I mean, they just send the entire, the global firefighters get there immediately, send drones in, spreading fire retardant as fast as possible. So those of you that have the feel, that hey, I am spirit, I know I'm spirit, you're right and they're wrong, plain and simple. You're right and they are absolutely mistaken. But we have compassion on them. We're neither staying nor leaving because we understand it's just continuity fear and that's all that it is. If it weren't for the continuity fear, they would awaken immediately and realize this is absolute nonsense what they've been spouting, complete nonsense. Immediately. Wouldn't be the slightest hesitation. So they're still members of our one family in perfectly good standing. Okay? Nobody can lose the perfect good standing of the one family. Nobody can. Everyone is absolutely members in perfect good standing of the one family. Okay? This is the truth. This is what I experienced in the vision of oneness. I saw this is absolutely true. It's just some are bedeviled by this severe continuity fear. Many are bedeviled by this continuity fear and they don't know what to do about it. They're ignorant. They're struggling, and this is what we're helping with. But certainly, when you have this new world order put in place, which denies this entirely. I mean, they're continuity fear deniers, which is like a trillion times worse than climate deniers. It's funny, they're screaming about climate deniers like this is like a capital offense, and yet they're continuity fear deniers, which is infinitely more problematical, infinitely more problematical, and yet they're celebrating that they're continuity fear deniers, like it's the best thing ever. So you talk about, things that are upside down. Yeah, they're a little bit upside down right now, to say the least. But we don't reject them at all. We know they are members in good standing of the one family, and there's no possibility they can ever be anything other than that. So like we say, I'm neither leaving nor staying. I'm neither staying nor leaving, right? I'm neither staying nor leaving. This is the attitude that makes a deal with the realm of continuity fear. I'm neither staying nor leaving. Yeah, continuity fear deniers. This is what's preached from every schoolroom in the world almost. This cradle to grave. We're told that there's this all-important belief and that we need to be continuity fear deniers. And if you don't, if you're not that, you're not truly human, and therefore you don't exist. You're not a true pretender, Arise, the true pretenders, and let your voice be heard. Arise, continuity fear deniers. Let us have our realm here, where we are not bothered by these lunatics who talk about continuity fear, and say that we're spiritual and not really, and it's all pretense, this is all pretense. Arise, pretense deniers, pretending, pretense deniers. Arise, continuity fear deniers. We will have our peace and happiness and prosperity without any interference. Again, they cannot lose their good standing, their perfect standing. Their perfect standing. We all have perfect standing in the one family, in the oneness. The one family of the oneness. We have perfect standing, everyone, which means we have perfect freedom. Our freedom is never abridged. No one's freedom is abridged, no matter how long they keep being continuity fear deniers. Their perfect freedom is never abridged in any way. No abridgment. Which brings to mind a dream I had last night where I started practicing. I am the now feeling. I am that now feeling. And I suddenly went into this sort of room, an alcove, underneath this huge bridge. And I was protected from the bridge. So, in other words, no abridgment is taking place with me, seeing that by practicing this, we will realize that no abridgment can possibly take place. Whereas above me, this alcove underneath the bridge was a huge bridge with massive traffic on this bridge. But I could just ignore it. I said, no, there's no abridgment taking place in the perfect standing of all of us in the one spiritual family of perfect freedom. We're just hanging out here in the continuity issue, and the continuity with the wow, as we evaporate this continuity fear and flip the script so severely, you see. Severely flipping the script on the world right here, right? So we're saying, wow, we can actually do this. I didn't know we could do this. I thought we were doomed. And now you're saying, we're not doomed. Oh, wow. That's a pretty big wow. Thinking that you're doomed and not realizing we're not doomed. Wow. We do need to make rapid progress. I am the now feeling. I am that one singular now feeling. It's the only feeling there is, and I am that feeling. I don't need any attempt at accomplishment to enhance the feeling, or success, or achievement, or arrival, or finishing, or succeeding, or improving, or progressing, triumphing. I don't need any speck of that. I am, already am, the one singular isness microclimate now feeling. I am that feeling. So just trying to state this with authority, your sovereign authority, is very powerful, even though you don't feel it yet. It's clearing the way, it's breaking the ice. Breaking the ice. You gotta make an omelet, gotta break some eggs. Well, if we wanna feel this, we gotta break the ice. I can, I will, I already am. I can, I will, I already am. I can, I will, I already am. So by learning this path and doing this, you become super helpful to others, because keep in mind, it's only their lack, it's their ignorance of the tools. That's causing them to suffer, just like I was ignorant of the tools when I was young and suffered so terribly from this terrible ignorance. So the more that practice this and you know, accept that I am the now feeling, the more this practice can be spread out, and you know, the more ignorance can be dissipated, which will save a massive amount of suffering for everyone. Because again, nobody can lose their perfect standing in the one family. The continuity fear says, hey, you know, whatever you had it, you lost it, don't worry about it. We can, let's move on from that, you know, and let's gain good human status here. And we can, let's work on that. Let's make equal status here in the world as humans, you know, and that'll be your happiness. You know, forget about the other stuff. Whatever you may have had, you think you had or believed you had, is all gone, it's all gone. It's not true. It's not been harmed in the slightest bit, it's not changed in the slightest bit. Everyone still has perfect status in the one family. Perfect status. And they always will. Always will. Having seen this, I am saying it's absolutely true. I couldn't abide in it because the wow reaction was so strong. I had to back away from it a little bit. But I'm absolutely sure this is what I experienced and saw. It was just such a huge wow. I said, "Oh my gosh, this, you know, I got to tell people about it. I should have just kept abiding in it." Because you're then able to more clearly, you know, be adamant about it and don't get so easily pulled back into the advice of continuity fear, or get tricked or get puzzled or stymied or, you know, by continuity fear and all its arrogance. I'm definitely getting hungry here. What is it? Okay. Trucking right along. Practicing right along. I am that one. I am the now feeling. That is all that I am. I am the totality of what I am is the now feeling. That is the totality of what I am. The totality of what I am is this one singular now feeling. This is the totality of what I am. And I am neither staying nor leaving. As far as perception, continuity, fear, all that goes, I am neither staying nor am I leaving. As far as honoring my creativity goes, I am neither staying nor leaving. The absolute totality of everything that I am is the now feeling, the feeling of now. That is the totality of what I am, and I'm nothing else other than that. It's total and complete. It's absolutely total, absolutely complete, the now feeling, just as it is. And as far as continuity, fear, and pretension, and creativity, I'm neither staying with it nor am I leaving it. I'm neither staying with it nor am I leaving it. Now, that microclimate of now feeling is what the saints refer to as the atmosphere permeated with peace. Ramana Maharshi says you know the saint by the atmosphere of peace around the saint, and in no other way do you really know the saint. If it's a saint, you don't really know. That is how you know. Is this a saint? Is there this atmosphere of peace permeating the area around the saint? Is it permeated by peace? Is that present? It's not the body of the saint, you know, is there some, you know, something you can see on the body. No, it's the microclimate of peace around the saint which determines, is this a saint? I am that now feeling. That is the totality of all that is the now feeling. There's only the now. There's only the now, and I am that now feeling. There's only the now, and I am that now feeling. There's only the now, and I am that now feeling. We don't need to compare. Well, what about this teacher, this teacher, this teacher? We're doing the right practice right here. So there's no, I don't feel any need to compare with what any other teacher seems to be doing or sharing. You know, we're doing what's right on track right here, so we just stay on track. And practice. Don't get into comparisons. That's the continuity fear game. It loves to get us into the comparison game. Because there's only one feeling, and I am that one feeling. I am that one feeling, the one singular feeling of now. I am that one singular feeling of now. And I am that microclimate of the one singular feeling that of now. I am that microclimate. I am that microclimate. It's not limited to the body. It permeates and spreads out. I am that microclimate. So hopefully there are a lot of people that are hip to this practice, right? Practicing. You don't just say, oh yeah, I be here now. Yeah, yeah, man, I got it. Far out. Now let's get high, you know? No. You're serious and you approach it intelligently with wisdom. Okay, so I got to practice here. What's the problem? Continuity fear is the problem. What am I doing? Asserting, full stop on the wow, flipping the script. Okay, so when the wow comes, I need to say I'm neither, you know, staying with this nor leaving this. I keep my intention strong. I'm going to keep practicing, but I'm going to take a time out from it, kind of, and just sort of just let me get used to this, acclimatized to it. And then insertions, we have I can, I will, I already am. Three levels of intensity with this. Three areas of that are in the practice I'm aware of. Flipping this, assertions, full stop in the wild, flipping the script. First, repentance. We come to the practice, the mood of repentance. I have a problem, that's great. My continuity for a problem is a super severe problem. It's the only problem I have. And I'm going to gradually evaporate and work on evaporating it. And I do that through this three-faceted practice of assertions, full stop in the wow, flipping the script. And the assertions have three levels of intensity to them. I can, I will, I already am. Okay? And I agree in this practicing to give up any external or internal actions. I'm not going to be impulsed into any action. I'm just going to sit here quietly. And I'm going to give myself a nice, good, long run at this so I give an opportunity to experience how being patient with the wow results in success. See, if we never give ourselves the opportunity to let the wow dissipate, let the continuity of fear evaporate and the wow dissipate. Wow is a mixture of elation and trepidation of in reaction to great success. If I never let it dissipate and catch a second wind and then go on further, then I'll never gain confidence that this practice works. I'll say, well, I don't know. But when we give it a good long run like this, a trial, we find out, hey, it really does work. I can even see that the progress I've made here is significant in this 2 hours, 2.5 hours. I've made significant progress. Wow. This is better than any drug trip. I mean, how long did a drug trip last? 2.5 hours or so? I don't know. Let's just say, you know, it's so instead of going on a drug trip, instead of getting drunk, drug trip, whatever, a jolt, you know, an amphetamine jolt. Super caffeine, guarana, ginseng, all the stuff they put you in, jolt. Instead of doing that for 2.5 hours, or guzzling Coca-Cola or Pepsi or whatever, Mountain Dew, you know, name it, caffeinated drinks, instead of drinking a six-pack of that, let's go on a 2.5-hour practice trip. Here, we're practicing, spiritual practice trip. And that's way more trippy than any drug trip, actually. Because you reinforce your understanding that this actually works. And what could be better than that? And it's smooth, and you say, I can really stay with this. I can keep doing this. I can keep doing it. So it's infinitely better than any drug trip. Or instead of going and watching a movie, going there, watching a movie, returning home, there's 2.5 hours right there. Or even watching a football game or a baseball game or some sporting event, which I'm doing less and less and less and less of. I'll have it on, and I'll, you know, if something happens, I'll come in and look, oh, okay, and then I go back to spiritual practicing, you know. It's not like you've got to be a, you know, St. Anthony in the desert hermit, you know, locked, you know, or cloistered nun, you know, locked in your cell, necessarily, There's nothing wrong with that. But, you know, when in Rome, do as Romans do to a certain extent. I mean, I might have a baseball game on, and oh, you know, Bumgarner's throwing a perfect game. Oh, let me take a look and see how he's doing. Oh, that's nice. You know, okay. But then I'm back to focusing on spiritual truth, you know. I just bop in and out. And it gives a little physical break, you know. Oh, TV's on in the kitchen. Let me walk in there and take a look. Oh, let me walk back. Let me sit down. Okay, I'm focused again. And a little bit of that, you know, you can work that into your life. You know, you don't have to, you know, and nobody really even knows I'm on the spiritual path anyway, because I just allow the accoutrement of humanism just to kind of be there, and I just work around it. Just work around it. Oh yeah, you know how the such and such do, you know, football season. Oh yeah, football. Well, you know, yeah. Too bad they didn't win that one. You know, will I take a peek at football? Maybe not. Probably not, because that really pulls you into the wrong mindset, the aggression, hyper aggression. You know, sumo aggression, bursts of hyper aggression. Many, many, many moments. And then the commercials are also extremely terrible and sleazy in football. You know, it's designed to make you think that you're human and not spiritual. That's a football. The whole football thing is all about. So I tend to be much more severe about that and say thanks, but no thanks. Yeah, I'll both be there and not be there. I'll both watch and not watch. This is how you should put it. Yeah, I'll both watch the game and not watch the game. Literally. And, you know, if you need a synopsis in the paper, you can always go there. Yeah, tough loss. Yeah, it was a tough loss. Yeah, fumbled it. Yeah, fumbled it. But a lot of people are really doing that. You talk in sports or talk in whatever. They're just getting synopsis of it, you know. They're too busy to really actually follow it. Yeah, tough. Hey, good win. Yeah, good win. Yeah, promise you. I like that. Yeah. Then that's it. Just let it go at that. Yeah, I drew that speech. Oh, yeah. I missed it. How was it? I was great. Oh, good. Okay. Meanwhile, you're saying, hey, I am that. The now feeling. I don't need any other feeling. I don't need to entertain any perceptual reactions at all. I don't have any reactions at all. I am the now feeling. I don't have any reactivity at all. I am the now feeling. I don't have any reactivity whatsoever. I am the now feeling. So yeah, I'm both reacting and not reacting. So a little bit of fasting, you know, a lot of spiritual practice, a lot of fasting, a lot of spiritual practice. You can go, you know, juice fasting is very good. I use grapefruit juice. I find it to be the most effective. I've done grapefruit juice fast many times. Other juices, it gets a little problematical. Making smoothies and all this stuff from fruits also is problematical. But just a simple grapefruit juice, why, you know, just keep it simple. And that'll work. You can go 2 weeks on that without feeling hungry. Then you start feeling the hunger. But absolutely, fasting and practicing. You know, design your life around spiritual practice. This is what what wisdom does. And we're speaking to both women here and men, which are, of course, just people, just equally pretense. Don't exist. We're really speaking to spirit here. Design your practice, you know. Have your habits that you're interested in now. And you have to be very artful about it. And sometimes you have to shift here a little here, shift here like that. You got to, it's an art, not a science. You have to keep dancing around the continuity fear and don't not let it grab you. You know, I'll set this one out. You say, "Wow, yeah, I love the dance, but I both love to dance with you and not love to dance with you. I'm neither going to dance with you, nor am I not going to dance with you. Or I'm going to both dance with you and not dance with you. I'm both dancing with you and not dancing with you." Just tell continuity fear this when it tries to hook you, as it will try to hook you ceaselessly. Say, "Yeah, I'm both dancing with you and not dancing with you." And actually, it'll accept that. This is one of the great helps that the Holy Spirit has shown me, the neither nor practice. You'll say, okay, all right, I understand. I accept that. Because at least you're acknowledging me, you know, at least you're acknowledging the creativity here. Denying the pretense, but acknowledging the creativity, and that's good enough. Or we accept that. There's a white butterfly. We almost never see butterflies around here anymore. It's unbelievable. There used to be so many butterflies. It's a huge change. Now we just have these sort of moth, like a white moth type of, what do they call those? Milkweed butterflies or something. The white ones that just flutter around. And that's pretty much all you ever see. And it's astonishing when you see an actual butterfly gliding by. What? You know, what is that? Haven't seen one of those in 15 years or more. I mean, the big yellow one. I mean, the monarchs I hardly ever see. The big yellow ones. There used to be so many. I like butterflies. You know.